This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so let's start with the overview. So as you can see, this is the AWS global infrastructure picture. So this orange circles, this orange circle represent the number of AWS regions available worldwide. You can see there are number of orange circles available. Some are US, UK, South America, North America. Even if you see in India, we have. Then the marks, the count inside this circle represent how many data centers are there. Now, data center is just a term, but technically you should not use this name data center. You should use AWS availability zone. Then, and this orange marks are nothing but the upcoming regions. So the region that AWS has introduced, but they are working on designing this infrastructure. So they are the upcoming regions, but all these other regions are available. Now, important point here, there will be no such region which is live, which has only one availability zone. There will be always two availability zones minimum in every region. Without this two availability zone, the AWS region never comes up. The reason why is, if in any case, if any disaster happen, or if due to network outage, if any of this availability goes down, then the other will survive. That's why AWS is providing two different availability zone in each region. Now, AWS physical infrastructure, that is region, are separated from a long distance, but the availability zone also are separated from a long region. In India, we have two availability zone, that is AP South 1A and AP South 1B, but they are still apart from each other along very long distance. And all these regions are linked to each other via Amazon dedicated link. So this Mumbai region is connected to North Virginia via dedicated link. There is a dedicated optical fiber link which has gone through the all the ocean, and it is connected via that service. So whatever the transition you will do from one region to another region, that will be very high speed internet connection. That will be you can just transfer your data from one region to another region within just few seconds because of this connection. So the AWS cloud spans across 61 availability zone with the 20 geographic region around the world, which announced, like AWS has announced 12 more availability zone upcoming in 4 different AWS region. A region is nothing but a geographic separated area. Like in Mumbai, in India, we have in US, in US West, in Singapore, etc. These are the physical location in the world where the multiple availability zones available. And the availability zone is nothing but an data center, which is an easier and effective way of design and operate application and database. So whatever the infrastructure we are creating under the availability zone. Then the third term is edge location. Now, if you know about these applications like Netflix or Amazon Prime Video, Hotstar, Musical.ly, these applications are designed over a content delivery network. So what is content delivery network? Basically, is in India, we have 4 or 5 edge location. Edge location just saves your data. It's like a cache. We have cache in our browser in a similar way. These are the cache storage. So for example, if somebody from the US has uploaded a video, and that video you are accessing from India. Now, whenever you request this kind of video, you have to face a high latency because you are in India, the person which has uploaded the video is in US. So you need to travel to US and it will then reach to you, which takes few seconds. But with this content delivery network, if you are the first user who are going to fetch this video, you will require the same time. But from the next time, whenever the other people will access to that video don't need to be go to the US and then fetch. And next time, these people will fetch that video from your edge location, because you are the one who has first requested that data, And once that the requested data is come to your region, it will be sent across all the age location. And from age location, and whenever the next time people will access to that video, they will access from the their nearest age location. In India, we have 5 age location: Mumbai, Hyderabad, Chennai, then Noida, and Bangalore, I guess. There are 4 or 5 abilities on age locations available. Now, you can also send your data across different ability zone, different age location via this content delivery network, which will help to people from US, UK, Canada, and other regions can access to your data in much faster way. So this is age location. Then the one of the most important part is share responsibility. For what part AWS is responsible and for what part you are responsible. This is very important to know what is your responsibility and what is AWS responsibility. So let's see AWS responsibility. AWS is responsible for maintaining the hardware or AWS global infrastructure like region, availability zone, and age location. So these are the responsibility of Amazon to take care of these things. And the software applications like computing, networking, database, and storage. So these are the 4 core services that not only AWS but other cloud computing platform will also provide the same. These are the 4 core services. So to maintaining all the hardware part, all the software part, whichever required to create an EC2 instance or VPC or creating an RDS instance, etc. This is the responsibility of AWS. Now you as a customer of AWS are responsible for encryption of data, that is client-side encryption, data server-side encryption, and networking traffic protection, that is access control list, who can access to your data and who cannot, who can access to your AWS account and not, all this information. Then maintaining and managing operating system, network, and firewall. So firewall, we have a firewall like in our regular infrastructure, we have a firewall something, we have to call security group. So this is our responsibility to maintain the operating system, to maintain the networking part and the firewall protection. Then maintaining the platform, that is what kind of application you are running, Java, Python, Go, Node.js, etc. So to maintain such kind of platform, this is your responsibility. Applications and IAM, that is maintaining the user, providing them authorization and authenticating right people to have access to your account, to you know, avoid the any kind of disaster or any kind of misconfiguration. This is your responsibility. And finally, customer data. So whatever the data you are uploading, this is your responsibility, how you upload the data and how you manage the data. Okay, so this is AWS responsibility and that's our responsibility. Do you have any question, any doubt?
No, I'm good.
Okay. We'll start our first topic, IAM. AWS IAM is a web service that helps you to securely control access to AWS resources for your user. You have complete control over authentication and authorization. So IAM is a management service from which you can have, if you are a head of your organization, so whatever the user will, you know, whatever the team members you have in your company who is going to access your AWS account, so to provide them authentication and authorization of AWS services from one service to another. Usually what happens, we hardcode all the credentials in our code, and that code will connect to your third party services and make a connection, then send the data across the parties. But in case of AWS, we are avoiding that part. We are using something like AWS role, which is a third party which will give authorized to one AWS service to another AWS service. For example, if EC2 instance, that is computing power, wants to have access to the storage S3, then when you attach a role that EC2 have access to use S3, then only this EC2 will be able to communicate with S3. Otherwise, the communication between these two services is denied. And it is subjected to all the services. All AWS services cannot talk to other AWS services. You need to provide the roles so that they can have authentication to, you know, access other AWS services. So this management services we are going to see in this IAM part. What are the benefits? It's like it has the enhanced security. So you have complete control of who is accessing what services. If, for example, if one of your team member is just an intern guy or junior person who has, you know, a less idea about AWS, or he's just started working on AWS. Now, providing him a right operations to all the services is not a good practice. So what you can do, you can just give him EC2 access, S3 access, or some services read access. So if he try to do apart from any of these services, if he go to CloudWatch, CloudFront, other AWS services, trying to do something, he won't be able to. Because of this, it provides an enhanced security. Because of the least privilege that you have provided, it gives you enhanced security option. It has granular control. So based on the role of a person, you can give them authentication. You can create temporary credential. So if someone is, there is some expert people have came to your company for configuring anything. So to provide, you should not give him your credential to log in and work on it. You can just give make a temporary credential for them, and he can just work on it for a limited period of time. Then flexible security credential management. You can easily, add permission or revoke the permission whenever required. So you can easily, you have a complete flexibility of maintaining and managing this permission. It also have a feature of leveraging external identity system. So considering big companies like Apple, Microsoft. So for such companies, like they have huge number of team members. Now to import and give them all the authentication to all these people, you can just directly use the federation option, where whatever the active directory is already present in your AWS account, in your open directory, you can federate all this user to your AWS account. You don't need to provide all this new user, whatever the username and password you have already assigned to these people. You can import all this username and password directly. So let's take a scenario. You have a dev team. Okay, this dev team wants to have access to EC2 instance, Lambda, and S3 bucket. Similarly, you have an AI team who wants access to Lex, Poly, and Recognition, these three different AWS services. Now, providing them complete control on AWS is not a good practice, because there is no need of a dev team to have access in the AI team and vice versa. So what you need to do, as a root admin, you need to create an IAM user and give them specific permission to have access what service they are going to access. If this dev team wants to have access to only EC2, Lambda, and S3, you should provide only these services. So, components of IAM. There are four components of IAM: user, group, roles, and policy. A user is like credential or a physical person who has authority to have access to your AWS account. So instead of sharing your root user credential with others, you can create individual IAM user with your account that correspond to the user in the organization. So whenever you first create an AWS account, you have one root access. You got one root user credential. This is first time access only. Then you can create an IAM user, or you can federate existing user from Active Directory kind of thing. So for every user in your AWS account, you should always create a new credential. You should not share credential between two people. You should always create a new credential for every single user. Then group. An IAM group is a collection of IAM user. Group let you to specify permission for multiple users, who can make it easy to manage and permission for the user. Now, let's consider a scenario. There are 50 people in your development team. Now, whatever the permission you want to give, you need to go to each user and give permission. Correct? For this every 50 people, you need to go to every single user inside it and change the permission. Now, in case of in future, if these people want to have access to other AWS services, for example, like currently you have given only EC2, in future they also require an S3 permission. So again, you need to do the same thing. Again, you need to go to each of the user and give them S3 policy. So to avoid such kind of things, you can use group. If there are 50 people in your dev team, you can just import all these 50 user, or you can just add this all these 50 user to your separate group called group developers, and you can manage permission at the group level. So whatever the permission you add or revoke, that will be applicable to all the users in that group. A group can contain many users, and user can belong to multiple groups. So a single user can be a part of a multiple group. If that a user can be part of a developer group, a user can be part of an admin group, etc. Groups can't be nested, they can be only user, not other groups. And there's no default group available, so that every people will, whatever the user you will get, that will be a part of an AWS account. And there is a limit to number of groups. I guess there are 50 on our limitations. Number of groups that you can create is maximum 50. So let's say there is an AWS account, your AWS account, and in that you have created three groups: group admin, group dev, and group security. And these are the users inside this different AWS groups. You have given special permission to dev, that is an explicit permission to dev to have, let's say, have access to the CloudFront. Similarly, you have given two more explicit permission to Summit. Now, this permission will be only applicable at the group level. But the permission you have given to the dev will not be applicable to the sushi. But whenever you use this permission at the group level, that is group admin, you have attached a policy, it will be applicable to both of these users inside that group. Similarly, what is the permission you give at the developer team group, it will be applicable to all these people. So now the third part is role. An IAM role is an IAM agent that you can create in your account that has specific permission. Roles are used to delegate access to user application services. As mentioned, whatever the services, AWS service you are connecting to each other, like EC2 to have access to the S3, you need to create a role between that. Just forget about what the credential you are providing, hard coding in your application and then communicating. You don't need to do that. With roles, you can attach a role between two AWS services and they can have now interaction between them. So role is a identity that provides authorization between two AWS services. And finally, the policy. Whatever the permission you are attaching to user, to a group, to a role, that can be done via policy. A policy is a document that defines what kind of authentication you are providing, what kind of permission you are defining. So this is just a common format of a JSON which defines a policy document. The first thing is version. So version is the 2012-10-17. This is something that Amazon has given. This is not a date. Just remember this part. This is not a date. This is a version ID that Amazon has given. And the second part is statement, which defines what kind of permission it is. So the permission is allowed, the effect is allowed, and the action is done on the S3. And if you want to specify a particular bucket in S3, you can provide that resource name here. So we will see actually how to create all these things, but just an overview how this in overview at a high level, what how it looks like the policy document. This is an example. So these are the body of a policy. What are the other things that we have seen? That is version, specify the version. Statement is the actual body container of the, all the elements. SID is something like if you are attaching multiple permission in a single policy, like a single policy with have EC2 access, S3 access, CloudFront access. So you can define this three different policy, these three defined permission via SID. That is, let's say 01, 02, 03. Effect, you can use allow or deny what kind of thing you need to provide. A principal is an account, for example, if you want to attach to a particular user, then you can just give him the ARN of that particular user. You can mention who, which user will have access to this services. or if you want to make it publicly available, then you can just use the asterisk mark, which define all the peoples in the world. Action, it lists all the action that policy allows, like EC2, S3, and number of services. What are the number of services available on Amazon? It will give you which service you want to allow. So action provide that. And resource specify what exactly permission you want to exact on if you want to specify on a specific resource, then you can mention in the resource section. A condition is optional, which define under which circumstances you need to allow this. You can write the if or not equal to such kind of sentences in here. So there are certain IAM best practices that we'll see later. First, we will go lab session. We'll see how to create all this thing, and then we will jump into this section.
Okay.
So I'm in my AWS management console, and here I can just directly search IAM. So this is my AWS console of my IAM dashboard, and this is a link that you will use that you need to provide to your AWS user to log into your AWS account. So for me, it says snapshot.signing.aws.amazon.com, but in your case, there will be a 12-digit number here. So if you want to customize that number, you can just add an alias here. For me, it says everything is correct, but for you, it will be like this only. So we will see one by one. First is activate MFA on your root account. So you need to activate then multi-factor authentication, that is two-step verification, for this account. So to do that, you need to click on here, manage MFA, and in the multi-factor authentication, you can click on activate MFA. Now you have two ways to do that: via virtual MFA, which doesn't require any kind of purchase. There is a default application present on Android Play Store or iOS Play Store. It's called Google Authenticator. You can use this Google Authenticator, or you can also use this Google Authenticator at the Chrome browser. Or there is another service called a hardware service. So there is a kind of thing is available in the market. You can just buy that hardware part and you can synchronize with it. So there is a Google Authenticator application is available. This is the application which is available on Google Play Store or iOS Play Store, or it is also available for the Chrome extension. So you can use any of
this part. I've downloaded that thing.
Okay, great. So we will go with the virtual MFA. Click on continue. And it shows the QR code. So you can just scan this QR code. Once you have scanned this QR code, you will get the code. So how to get code? This is the one way if you want to scan it. The second way is show secret key, and this is a secret key. So you can just copy this. And I have in my Chrome browser, I have given the extension, so I will use that. This is a Chrome extension of Google Authenticator. So to do that, you can just click on scan to scan with the exact QR code, or you can just add it and then add, that is manual entry, and here you can provide this account, and you can here provide the secret key and click on OK. So this is the code. You can just copy
this
code.
Your video is stuck because it's still in your virtual MFA.
Is it?
Yeah, it's not moving. Like, can you move your pointer because it's not moving? Yeah, now I'm now I'm able to see your home screen. Yep.
Okay. Now, so I'm in my MFA 4.1.
Yeah.
while
Now I'm
flying
able
through.
to see your authenticator.
Okay. From my side, it's working fine. Internet connection is working fine.
Yeah, now you are on your Amazon, right? Yeah, now I'm able to see.
Yeah. So this is the first code that I have written. I copied from that Google Authenticator and provided here. And I need to wait for a certain time so that it will show the new code.
Okay.
The code basically changes after every 30 minutes. So 30 seconds, sorry. So you need to wait for that 30 seconds and then provide both the keys and then click on assign MFA. Once the thing is applicable, once we have assigned this MFA, whenever you now log into the next time to this AWS account, you need to use this signing keyword. So what you need to do, you need to first provide your username, password, and once it is successfully verified, you will opt for a screen where you need to provide this two-step verification. So you need to copy this name of this number from your mobile phone or extension, and you need to provide it here. So once you are done, you can just simply click on assign MFA and it's ready.
Okay.
Then we have user. So click on user from the left pane side. Just a second, I will just reconnect. I think it's
okay.
Showing lag. Can you see my screen?
Yeah, I'm able to see your screen. Yep.
It's in the user mode that we are creating a user now.
I'm
so
not
click
able
on
to see you now. I'm not able to see you now.
Add user. And
Hello,
you can
I'm not able to see you now. Hello?
What is happening?
Yeah, now I'm able to see. Sure.
Yeah. Hello, yeah.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yeah, please tell me.
Yeah, no. I wasn't able to see your screen, but now I'm able to see. Yeah, please continue.
So here you can write any kind of name or whatever the username you want to provide. Let's go with the John. And what kind of access do you want to provide? Do you want to? Yeah, I can hear you. What? Okay. So what kind of access do you want to provide? If that user is only have only CL, that person, then you provide them programmatic access so that you will get key and security at the printer you log into your machine via CLI. Or AWS management console. This is what we are interacting with. This is a management console. You can share this number as well. The next part is password. Like, do you want to auto generate a password or do you want to send a custom password? This is completely your choice. And a password reset. First, reset your password. Okay. Then simply click on next permission. Okay. So we have three kinds of permission here: add user to group, copy permission from existing user, or attach policy. So you can use any of this feature. If you want to specifically apply any certain policy to this user, you can use this for thing, attach existing user. And here you can search what kind of permission. Let's say EC2 full access. So I can just search here EC2 full access.
Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Let's do one thing. Sorry for the inconvenience. Let's start tomorrow. Again, I think there is some disturbance in the network.
Yeah, because there's a lot of lag because your video is somewhere else, I am somewhere else, your words are somewhere else. So it's not matching.
Yeah, I can see that. I can see that on screen. It's okay.
Yeah.
Do you have time in the evening?
In the evening?
Just for today.
Yeah. What is the time? Because I'll be in office like tomorrow morning.
Okay. So it's okay, fine. Then we'll start tomorrow morning itself again. Lab session.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry for this inconvenience. I don't know exactly.
No problem. Like, it was a good session. I had
okay.
A lot of things. I'll just review them.
Okay. Great. I'll just share you this video so you can have, once again, recap of all these things.